So, we've spoken to Rory Stewart. We would very much like to speak to Boris Johnson because he is, of course, the man to beat despite barely any media appearances.
Well, he even ducked last night's TV debate where he was called out by fellow candidates for not turning up. And joining us now from Westminster is Conservative MP and Brexit Minister James Cleverly, who is now representing Boris Johnson.
How does that feel, James Cleverly?
Having had the impossible task of defending Theresa May for a year or two, you're now having to do the same with Boris, who refuses to face up to the media. Why is he such a gutless coward when it comes to debates and the media, Mr. Cleverly?
Well, I thought if you squint really, really hard, we kind of look vaguely similar.
Could you don't look similar at all.
You don't look anything like Boris Johnson, and I imagine you're nothing like him either in real life.
No, seriously,
why is he a gutless coward? Why doesn't he come out and defend himself and explain how he will sort out Brexit, answer difficult questions? Why is he sending out, with respect to you, the foot soldiers to do all the fighting for him? It's a bit cowardly, isn't it?
So, you and I, Piers, have discussed this. And when I was running, I came on the show and you gave me a grilling, and that was completely appropriate. And I didn't get through. I didn't get the votes that I needed. Whereas Boris actually topped the poll of Members of Parliament with, was it 114 votes? Mm. So whilst I was talking to you in the studios, he was talking to MPs in Westminster. He was successful, I wasn't. So I think I'm big enough to recognise that actually he had the right strategy, which was talking to the Members of Parliament, who are the people voting at this stage of the
competition. So look, we've got you de facto Boris, so we have to interview you basically on his behalf, right, which is fine. But there are difficult questions about Boris, and one of them is, you know, the infamous private life that comes with him and how much of that is relevant to him being the leader of the Conservative Party, to being Prime Minister. I'll just ask Rory Stewart a pretty basic question about a potential Prime Minister. How many children does he have? Do you, James Cleverly, know how many children Boris Johnson has?
Well, I'm not going to discuss the private lives of any of my Conservative colleagues. I don't gossip about people's private lives.
Is that fact private life, or is it something that the British public should just be entitled to know?
No, it's absolutely private life. And as I said, I don't gossip about anybody's private life. So, you know, that's
so the
that's
British
my
public
position.
Is not entitled to know how many children Boris Johnson has.
No, what I said is, I am not going to discuss other people's private lives.
I get it. My follow-up question is the British public entitled to know the answer to that question, or is that a secret?
Well, there have been plenty of articles written about Boris, probably more than hundreds, about him, about his private life. So if people want to read about him, they can. Actually, my view is that if you're choosing who is actually going to run the country, the more important thing to look at is their record of running stuff. And one of the reasons why I'm supporting him is because I saw Boris running City Hall in London, city of 8.5 million people, huge police force, huge transport network, huge economy, and he did it demonstrably more successfully than either his predecessor or his successor. Okay. And that is a very real reason why I'm backing him for Prime Minister.
So he's so proud of his record that he won't defend it. He won't appear himself and talk about it. And one of the reasons he won't with respect, Mr. Cleverly, one of the reasons Boris Johnson won't do shows like this, won't come out and talk to the media, is precisely because of the kind of question that I put to you, which are just basic things which most leaders would be very happy to share with the public. There's a whole side to Boris Johnson, away from the maverick, the charismatic guy and all the rest of it. I've known Boris a long time. I like him personally, right? But there are basic fundamental questions about him and his life, which many would argue are relevant to somebody who wants to be Prime Minister.
Well, some people will argue that. Some people do argue that, I'm sure. But as I say, for me, the thing that matters the most, the things that will actually affect other people's lives are about the economy. And whilst he was Mayor of London, he helped keep the London economy afloat.
If you want to be Prime Minister, do we trust this person? And that's why I think in Boris's case, actually, questions about his life and the way he's conducted himself become relevant. And I'm surprised that you, as a a senior member of the party, view all that stuff as completely irrelevant.
So the point I'm making is, you're right, it is about trust. Who do you trust to run policing in the UK? And I would point to his record running the largest police force or providing the governance for the largest police force in the country. And last night we had Bernard Hogan Howe, who was the commissioner of the Metropolitan Police whilst Boris was mayor, supporting Boris because of how he ran policing when we're in London.
But James Cleverly, when he was Foreign Secretary, he made comments about Nazanin Zaghari Ratcliffe, which people say mean that she is still imprisoned in Iran. So you might point to his record as mayor of London. Other people will point to his you know, gaffes in other areas, the comments that he's made about Muslim women looking like letterboxes, you know, the things which have actually led people to feel threatened, at risk. You know, that some areas he's had success, other areas he's misspoken, and some people think that's one of the reasons that he doesn't do many interviews at the moment, because you're afraid that he might say the wrong thing.
The sad truth Mrs. Zaghari Ratcliffe is that she is imprisoned because of an evil regime in Iran. If you read the article, he makes the point that whilst there is a widespread across Europe calls to ban the burqa, and even though he has personal reservations, he doesn't believe it should be banned because that's not what an open, tolerant, liberal society like the UK should be about.
When's he going to do his next live interview, James Cleverly?
My understanding is that he's going to be doing the BBC hustings. He did hustings yesterday. On Saturday with hundreds of Conservatives. There'll be hustings all over the country.
Okay.
He had been interviewed on Radio 4.
OK, well, look, we haven't seen Boris for nearly 2 years on this programme. We'd love to interview Boris, right? I think many other people would too. I just think there's something a little bit gutless and cowardly about him sending you out to do all the difficult stuff, because you did all that for Theresa May. I mean, you're obviously worn out with all this, aren't you? Defending the indefensible.
I am, like Rory was saying, I am proud of the party that I serve. I am proud of the fantastic achievements that we have had in government, stabilising the economy, helping businesses grow jobs, reducing unemployment.
Are you proud of a surge in food banks?
Our food bank use is less than in a number of other countries across Europe, including France and Germany.
So you have no issue in the fact that use of food banks in this country has spiked under your government?
I would love to see the use and the need for food banks reduced. And the best way of doing that is getting people into employment.
Okay.
And we've had an increase in employment, the like of which has been unseen across comparable economies.
All right, Mr. Cleverly,
we have to leave low levels of unemployment.
We have to leave it there.